Hello, people of the future, and welcome to Let's Make a Trading Card Game, Episode 1. This is my name, but you can call me Tok for short. I'm designing and developing a trading card game, or TCG, which doesn't have a name yet, and is codenamed The Mothership. It's a turn-based strategy card game set in a galaxy. You build up resources, play creatures, and build structures. You can explore the galaxy, discover and colonize planets, battle, of course, your opponent, and try to conquer their home planet. But before we get into the behind the scenes of me actually making the trading card game, let's establish, what is a TCG? How does it differ from a traditional card game like Hearts or, I don't know, Uno or poker? Well, the main thing about TCGs is that they are games that are bigger than the box, so to speak. TCGs often have thousands of different cards printed, all different from each other, but players play with just a small sample of those cards. The point of trading card games is to give freedom to the players to choose whatever cards they want to play with. Each player chooses cards from their collection and makes a customized deck of their own. So it's up to the player to decide what cards they play with, and they are free to choose any particular strategy that they like, or they can decide to come up with something creative and new, and come up with their own unique combination of cards that fits their style of play. In theory, at least, because as soon as you let players choose their cards, or their weapons, you come up with the problem of balance. Now, let me explain. Okay, so let's imagine for a second that you're playing five-card poker in a tournament in which you're allowed to bring your own fully customized deck to draw cards from. The deck can contain any cards out of the 52 that are printed, you know, the standard deck of cards. I have a cheap deck, as you can see here. Okay, well, let's see. What cards should we pick? Oh, that's easy. You just choose always the aces and make a deck out of 52 aces. You buy some of these decks and then get to the point until you have 52 aces and build a deck which has only aces, and you'll win every time. Unless, of course, you're playing against someone who also figured this out, in which case nobody wins. But either way, the point is that the game breaks instantly. Since all of the other cards are objectively worse than aces, they don't matter at all. They stop mattering. Maybe this is an extreme example, but you get the idea. If some cards are objectively worse than others, in a game where you choose what cards to play with, the worst cards don't matter. So you want to have all the cards somewhat balanced, so you actually have a choice when constructing your deck, when putting cards into your deck. You have a choice between different strategies or something. Okay, so you have to make all of the cards matter in some way or another. You can make some cards stronger in certain strategies and weaker in others, for example, or some can be very good against certain strategies, but bad against others. Some can be good early into the game and others late into the game. What else? Some can be better when you're winning and some when you're losing. And so on. But most importantly, you need to avoid aces that break the game, that invalidate all the other cards or a part of the other cards. You need to let the players have an actual choice when having... If you're having so many cards to choose from, you better make all the choices matter, all the cards matter. So there's an actual choice. Okay, well, of course, no trading card game is perfectly balanced, but you can balance it somewhat if you employ some sort of system that prevents players from filling their deck with the strongest cards and make more cards matter more of the time. So different trading card games have different ways of doing that, and they succeed to various degrees. But I'm not going to talk about them right now. In the Mothership, you start the game on your home planet, and the planet at the beginning of your turn will produce resource, typically 2 units of resource per turn. Cards you play have a small resource cost in the corner of the card that shows you how much resource is needed to play the card, how much resource you have to pay to play the card from your hand. So on your first turn, you have 2 resource, and you can play a card that costs 2, you can play 2 cards that cost 1, or you can play a card that costs 1 and leave 1 resource for your next turn, or you can play nothing and have 4 units of resource on the next turn. So you can play something that costs more, a more powerful card, because stronger cards will cost more units of resource, and therefore players won't be able to play as many of them during a game, and you can't just wait until you gather enough resources to play your powerful cards, because if your opponent has weaker cards that they can play out faster, they'll be able to just attack you sooner and do things sooner, and they'll try to defeat you before you even gather all of your resources, and before you get to play your cards. So already this resource system creates 2 basic strategies of play, the aggressive strategy and the defensive strategy. The aggressive one being where you try to play as many weak cards, or rather cheap cards, as soon as possible and as fast as possible, and try to win the early game. And the defensive strategy, in which you try to hold off your opponent until you have enough resources to play your powerful stuff. And players now have a choice. They can choose to build a more aggressive or a more defensive deck. Both strategies are valid, and it's up to the player to choose what style of play they prefer. Now, in the Mothership, not all resource is the same. There are 4 different flavors of resource, and the planet typically produces only 1 of 4 types of resource. And each type is represented by a different color, and cards will require resource of a specific color to be played. Cards of the same color follow a general theme, and players will have different ways of approaching the Mothership game when playing in different colors, with cards of different colors. Each color has a certain characteristic, or certain characteristics that define it, and has a different way of tackling its obstacles. So red values courage, speed, strength, and perseverance. Its symbol is a flame. Its strategy is to hit as hard and as much as you can until you reach your goals. It battles with passion and fearlessly. Red is driven by emotion, by anger, by rage, but also by honor and love. Red is the most explosive of the colors. They tend to blow stuff up and, you know, beat people up. But then there's blue. Blue values intelligence, knowledge, research, and planning. Its symbol is a spiral. Blue likes to be prepared for anything. They learn about the problems they face and study them and find an effective way to beat them. They tend to avoid blunt confrontation and prefer to defeat their enemies by outsmarting them, luring them into traps, or exploiting flaws they didn't know they had. Blue thinks that if you know more, you will be more prepared against more things. They like being in control of the situation. Okay, and, you know, predicting things. Green values cooperation, strength in numbers, growth and expansion. Its symbol is a tree. Its strategy is to gather as many resources as possible, build, as you know, grow a society, a community, and overwhelm the opponent with the sheer numbers. They think that working together you can achieve anything, and a person may be weak by himself, but a crowd is an unstoppable force. And lastly, there's yellow. Yellow values political and economic power. Their symbol is a scale. Yellow will go to any measure to achieve its goals. They have no scruples. They may make deals with their enemies, and they may break those deals later. They can take advantage of the less fortunate and corrupt the more powerful. They pull strings and work in the shadow until they achieve what they are looking for, so they really couldn't do anything. So different players, of course, will have a preferred way to play the Mothership game, and having different planets produce different resources allows for more variety in strategy, and there are certain things that can be done in one color and that can't be done in another, and since a planet produces only one type of resource at a time, it's harder to play the strongest combination of cards in the game, in the whole game. It's not impossible, but you have to work for it. You have to find a way to play multiple colors, which is tricky. So, by introducing into the Mothership this resource system, I can create all sorts of strategies and keep them somewhat balanced while providing the players with choices and basic styles of play from which to choose from. And of course, players can be creative within those styles of play, and they can mix and match cards from different colors if they want, and come up with unique combinations and ways of playing the game, unique decks. Okay, phew. Sorry, this was a long monologue, but I had to explain the basics of how cards for the Mothership are made. It took a long time to work out the resource system for the Mothership. I had so many versions, and finally this one I think is really good. It's really solid. Let's get to making cards. Let's actually go behind the scenes and make some cards.
So here we are in Excel, and this works if you want to keep your database, card database, sorted, and you can see all the cards. So I use this for creating cards for the Mothership, and I have a database here, which is actually a database for the entire base set, but this has the old version of the resource system, and it still has six colors, and they're not as well defined as the four that I have now. They were iffy, but I think I'll recycle many of these cards into the new database. These names aren't final, they're just working names, like bring back from the dead. It's exactly what it sounds like. Rain. Fully heal plants on a planet. Makes sense. Disorient, Bedouin. Many of these cards are just filler. So I could create a full set and then test it with friends and see if the game would work. And it turns out it works. Even in this raw form. Anyway, the first thing that I do when creating cards is just come up with ideas and just dump all of the ideas I have for cards that you might expect from a game that is set in the galaxy and is essentially a space fantasy. So you might find a turret. That's you can build and people fire up. So let's call it small turret. Will cost, I don't know, one for example. One resource of any color. Range one. These are abilities that the card can have in the rules text, or abilities and stuff that it does in the game. Type structure, subtypes. Building, no speed, power, I don't know, 2/2. Okay. That's a pretty generic card. For more complex cards that have a certain identity, they will fit in one of the four colors that I have told you about. So, for example, if I want to have a card that teleports creatures from one place to another, let's call it teleport. For now, I don't know what it will cost. Let's do it later. So it will move a creature from one explored space. It's hard to talk and type at the same time. Explored space to another. it's a pretty powerful effect. Those creatures are really important in this game. It will be an action. No subtypes. Speed, power, health, no stats. And this card is blue in its essence, because, as I've said, blue wants to be in control of the situation, and when you are able to move any creature from one place to another, you can manipulate the game in whichever way you want. So it's a powerful ability, it's a blue ability. So I haven't tested this card yet, of course, so I'll just say that it costs three resource of any color and one blue. This already means that you'll have to play it in a deck with planets that produce blue resource. So that's how I would make cards different colors. There are two ways of designing cards. There's top-down and bottom-up. These two have been designed top-down, meaning that I've started with the concept, with the idea of, teleporting one creature to creatures from one place to another, and then made it so it fit the game. If I were to design this card bottom-up, I would have started with saying, oh, I need a blue action that does a powerful effect and helps you being in control of the situation. And then I would come up with something like teleport. It's just two ways to design a card. And I would generally start by designing things top down. If you design things top down, you start with a concept, and if I want to create cards that feel natural, that feel like the things that you know, it's better if I start with an idea that you already have some preconceived idea, notion about, like a satellite, for example, that it orbits planet, or, I don't know, a space pod that can hold only one person and doesn't attack. It's just a means of transportation. And then I create a card that matches your preconceived notion. And I'll start with this. I'll just start brainstorming ideas and then putting them into cards that fit in the game. Now, again, I haven't told you the rules, but I'll tell them some other time, I don't know. So I think that's enough for this episode. See you next time, and until then, keep it up.